chapter 1, we're going to look at the first four verses. Now we have no excuse not to. I appreciate the board decided that we want some new Bibles. You can see the Bibles that are in your computers, very good. And I expect people to know the Word of God unless we put the Word of God in front of them. And so we're going to look here at, Mark's going to read for us here in just a moment. It's kind of like from on high. So follow with him if you would, Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 through 4.
In the past, God spoke to our forefathers through the prophets at many times and in many various ways. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, and through him, through whom he made the universe. The Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things by his powerful word. After he had provided purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty in heaven. So he became as much superior to the angels as the name he has inherited is superior to theirs.
The letter to Hebrews, and we're not going to debate who wrote it. We don't know who wrote it. I think the Apostle Paul did, but that's a secondary note on that. It's a book that is written to people who are giving up their faith. Now, they're not giving up their religion. They're giving up their faith. And the writer is going to write this, trying to get across to them about the danger that they're in. There's a lot of times that he gives us warnings about what's going on. And these people are just a generation away from Jesus. 30 years, probably, this letter is written after the resurrection of Christ, and already in this generation and the next generation, something is being lost here. Okay? And we see that in our society, do we not? For a number of reasons, that we are, our faith is not quite as serious to us as it used to be. So as we begin, what might cause someone to abandon their faith in Christ? Remember, when it's a question, that means you get to talk.
Some type of hardship
that we'll go through, okay?
Death.
Okay, death in the family, okay, or a friend.
Lack of knowledge of the word.
Okay, lack of knowledge. Yeah, we are not Bible knowing society anymore. Used to be, but not so much anymore. I know, I'm getting off base a little bit. I shared this with you before. I have a friend that is a minister. I'm thankful it's not in a Christian church. But he doesn't read from the Bible from his sermons anymore because he found that it offended some of the people in the church.
Wow.
Okay? I know of churches that have taken the Lord's Supper and moved it into another room where it's not part of the main service. You can go in there when you want to, and things like that. Okay? We have become Bible illiterate. And that's why when we are threatened by things, we don't know what the Word of God says, so we can't defend ourselves because we don't know what God has said to us. Other reasons why people might abandon their faith.
Stupidity.
Stupidity? Well, that's in my case. Don't get personal. Yes. Okay, the temptation, the influence of the world. Absolutely, very good. Anybody else? For me?
Just having a series of bad luck.
You know, bad luck? Okay. Okay. I always like that song, I can't tell you the title, by Casting Crowns. It says your life is not falling apart, it's falling into place. Okay? So sometimes we think those are hardships, but in every one of these things, what happened is our attention got distracted to something else. We got pulled away. And I would bet that there's a lot of people that if I asked them that question, they'd say, I didn't even know I had straightway. Wasn't even aware of that. Sometimes that happens to us. It's not a big crisis. Most times I find that the crisis, we stay faithful. It's out of the crisis that we begin just to fade away a little bit and not being able to stay. So I don't know what the problem is here with these people, but what I am concerned about is what hangs in balance. You know, we seem no longer to be that concerned about our eternity. We don't seem to be that concerned about our salvation. Maybe we don't believe in heaven and hell anymore. We can just go on and on about that. But if you want to talk to someone, I can tell you that most people aren't that concerned about spiritual things. They're not. Okay? So they're caught up in their religious beliefs just like these people are, but they have lost their faith. I told you before that you'll leave Jesus long before you ever leave the church. You may never leave the physical church, but you will have walked away from Jesus along the line for whatever reason it might be, okay? And what you're talking about, these struggles coming up, that we become Christians, and then what happens, life happens. That our expectations of what God's supposed to do, it doesn't happen that way. I don't know how many of you, I've seen them always. When I go to shop anywhere, I always get that one shopping cart that's got that wheel that goes like that all the way up. Or it's got a flat spot, so when you're walking that, ka-wonk, ka-wonk. Life does that to us, doesn't it? Okay? I washed some, dried some clothes last night, and the one thing that came to my mind, that life was kind of like me trying to fold fitted sheets last night. You start out, and I knew I was going to get this right this time. I started out, and by the time I got done, I just took it all in a freaking pile. Life happens that way. Okay? And when it's not, you know, there was a time that what we called the health and wealth gospel, there was a time when people preached that, boy, if you become a Christian, you're never going to have another problem in your whole life. So I became a Christian. I waited for somebody to leave $25,000 at my front door. No new car, no new anything. Okay? And what happens is that life comes back to normal. We fight through things just like non-Christians. Okay? So what happens then is that through all of this, life kind of beats us up a little bit, and we begin to question God. Wait a minute. Is this supposed to happen? Is this supposed to happen? You know, I think of the story of a young man, his name was Chris Charles. He always wanted to be a boxer. So he trained, and he trained, and finally he got his first chance at boxing. Okay? So we got out there in the ring, and his manager said, boy, just stick in there, Jeff, you're going to do fine. In the first round, they went back and forth, and his opponent hit him a couple pretty good shots, but it didn't faze him or not. And after the first round, he went over, he sat down, and the manager says, stick in there, Chuck, he hasn't laid a glove on you. Okay. So he gets to the second round, and he fights, boxes, and this time his opponent hits him hard three or four times, and he's dazed a little bit. The end of the round, he goes back over the corner. The manager says, stick in there, Chuck, I haven't laid a glove on you. Chuck looks at his manager, okay. So he goes out the third round, and as he's fighting, he gets clocked pretty good. He goes down on his knees. But fortunately, at the seven count, the round is over. And he struggles back to the corner, sits down, and his manager looks at him, says, stick in there, Chuck, he hasn't laid a glove on you. And Chuck looks at his manager and says, now, I'm going to go out there and fight this round. But you watch this referee because somebody's beating the devil out of me. Life is like that. Sometimes it just beats us up. And in our human nature, we decide that we're going to give up on God then? That God's not acting the way I thought he should act? So now we start separating ourselves just very gradually. And what I'm giving to you here is what these people are doing. Okay? That we all struggle through this, that the first generation is all enthused and all excited about everything, but the second generation, not so much. They're not sticklers to hold on to the faith. On the religion, yeah. Most of these people are going to be Jewish in their background. They're going to know the Old Testament. They're going to practice all the ceremonies. And if you listen to my radio program, that's one of the things that I kind of go after all the time. Ceremony doesn't make it for me. Ritual doesn't make it for me. There's got to be meaning. There's got to be purpose behind what you're doing. Not just go through the motions of that. But that's what these people are going to end up doing. You know what that's called in the Bible? Religion. Religion. And in fact, in Acts 17, when the Apostle Paul goes to the Areopagus, Mars Hill sermon, he says to them, I see that you are very religious people. The word is superstition there, OK? okay? But you don't know whether that's a good thing or a bad thing. That's how it gets the audience to keep listening to it. That's what I want to say. Well, have we taken our faith and it's become superstition? Well, if I go to church this Sunday, I'll have a good week. I mean, we just go on and on. That's not faith, that's superstition. Now, we have to look back at the true faith in Christ. So the question I had to ask, what is the very basis of your Christian faith? Now, you don't have to answer all of it if you don't desire to do that, but think about that. What is the true basis of your faith in Christ? Okay. Anybody want to share that? See if, yes?
Well, a lot of times you can pray and pray, and if it isn't answered right away, you start to lose a little bit of faith. That isn't what it's all about.
That's right. Okay, you're getting close. I hate to admit that, but he's got a point. You go home, tell Cindy, he said something good at church today. Absolutely. What's the bigger principle that Pete just shared with us? That I believe in God because of what he does for me. And when he doesn't do it, then there's a problem. Because this is supposed to be about me. And you pray and you pray. Pete, I can tell you, there's things I prayed for a long time, never happened again. I was glad it didn't, because I'd been all messed up if I had my way. Okay? What else? Think to yourself, is your faith based upon God doing what you want him to do? As long as he's doing everything that you like, then your faith is there to you.
If he follows his word of your honor, he will be in glory and heaven.
Okay, you think so? Absolutely. Okay? Follow him. Not because of what he does or doesn't do, but because of who he is. That's what this passage we're looking at in Hebrews is all about. The writer of Hebrews, when he's going to take the people back here, it's going to be about who Jesus is, and he shares that with them. Okay? If you, we're not going to get deep into this, but I will mention it back and forth. If you go through the book of Hebrews, the word better or superior is mentioned 13 times. In the letter. And every time it's about Jesus is better than the angels. Jesus is better than the temple. Jesus is better than Moses. He just goes on. He's superior to all of this. That's why our faith has to be in him, because it's all about him, who he is. It's who he is that makes all the difference in the world. Okay? So when we look at these few verses here, we're going to start by looking at the idea that Jesus is superior. And the first thing is, not that. There. He is a superior person. Folks, it's about who he is. Okay? I can't stress that too much. It's about who he is. Not who I think he is, not who I want him to be, but who he is. Look in the passage of Scripture here and give me the names that are spoken of about Jesus. And you can do that out loud if you want. What's the first name he gives to Jesus? The Son. He's the Son. Okay? What's the second name? Pardon me? Okay, he's the heir of all things. In verse 3, the Son is what? The radiance of God's glory. He is also what? Exact representation, a characterization of God. Okay? So when we look at who he is, the writer begins by these names about Jesus that makes him absolutely, absolutely superior in all ways. Okay? Now, when we admit, if it's true, admit, that this is trying to come from a place to this, that we don't sense the excitement, the beauty of these names of who Jesus is. Really is. Okay. I remember in a Billy Graham crusade, the story was told about a man that came forward one night, and they asked him why he came forward, and he said, I believe I've been a Christian all these years, but I realized I have not been decent to Jesus. I think that's what we're talking about. It just becomes kind of everything. We read this. What does it mean that he's the Son of God? What does it mean that he is the radiance of God's glory? What does it mean that he is the exact representation of God? The writer of Hebrews, I think, is probably jumping up and down when he's writing this. This is the key to everything. Without Jesus being who he is, we're wasting our time here. This is of no value whatsoever unless we come to terms as much as our human brain will help us is to become like him, that he is superior in all ways. We're going to go back one here, that he says in times that God spoke to different people in different ways. What are some of the ways he did that in the Old Testament? What? Okay, sometimes the angels would speak. Okay, he would talk in the burning bush. God used all kinds of ways, didn't he? The prophets came, and God would reveal partially to these Old Testament figures what his plan was. Do you understand that? That Isaiah, Jeremiah, and all their prophecy, they never knew the whole story here. Nobody knew the whole story. They knew their part. Okay? But it came down to only in Christ was the whole message given. In fact, in 1 Peter, Peter says that even the angels stretched to see. They wanted to know what the plan was, and nobody knew. Nobody knew. It was just the foreshadowing of what God had done, what God was going to do as far as the Son. But the full revelation comes with him. Okay. Look in the passage again here. Verse 1, in the past God spoke to our forefathers through the prophets of many times in various ways, but in these last days he has, what does it say? Spoken. Okay, it's over with. That in different ways, God spoke through the prophets, through the forefathers, all these people they spoke to, but he has spoken to us through his Son. Revelation from God is over. It's perfect, past tense, it's done with. He has spoken, and now we have the full story of what God was doing all the way from Adam all the way to the birth of Jesus. It's complete. That I don't have to be religious anymore. I can be Christian now. Big difference. You know, people say, well, Joe, you're a religious guy. No, I'm not. I don't want to be. That's not a good connotation to me. I'm a Christian, but I'm not religious. I'm not religious, okay? So the whole thing now comes down to this relationship that I have with this person in Jesus. See, religion is man's attempt to find out about God. Christianity in Christ is God telling us what he knows about us. That he has revealed now the truth, the whole truth in Christ and Christ alone. There's an old saying that I come across that said, if it doesn't go back to Jerusalem, it's not old enough. If we don't go back to here, then the revelation that you say you have isn't from God whatsoever. And if God has spoken through the Son, then there I don't have to worry about what anybody else said because it all comes down to him. That Christ is superior to any religious system, even ours. He is superior to what we see in our religious life. Because what happens here is Christ shows us what God is all about. He's the radiance of God's glory. In Matthew 17, at the transfiguration, the disciples got to see just a little bit of that. When Jesus is transfigured before them. Just a little bit of the nature of who Jesus really is. And now we have the opportunity to see it all. To see it all. He says that he is the exact representation of his Father. Now, who can claim that? Wouldn't that be absurd unless it's true? He's the exact representation of the Father. In John chapter 1, verse 18, it is John that says that Jesus has come and he has explained God. He made him know, didn't know about it. Jesus will say the only one that can explain the Father is who? The one who has been with the Father. And he is the only one. One of those passages of the Bible that we kind of skip over at times, and I point this out a lot to people, in John chapter 14, we know verse 6, don't we? I'm the way, the truth, and the life. But in verse 9, after the disciples said, show us the Father, and we'll be satisfied, you know what Jesus' answer was? How can can you ask me to show you the Father? You've seen me, you've seen the Father. How can you ask me to show you the Father? Now, that's an absurd statement unless it's true. And it is. Jesus said, you look at me, you'll know exactly what God is like. Nobody else, well, others can claim that. Okay? I can't say that if you see Dan Hughes, you'll see me. Because he's the new improved version, right? Pardon me? Give me just one moment. New improved model, just not well educated enough. But we can't say that, but Jesus can. If you see me, you've seen the Father. Don't ask what God is like. I can know what He's like. I have people say that to me a lot. Well, we can't really know what God's like. Yes, I can. Jesus has come for that very reason. It's like the little girl that they asked her about knowing about God. And she said, well, some people can't hear God's whisper inside of them. So he sent Jesus just to yell to them out loud. And that's what he has done in physical form. And he has come to earth. How much better can we have than that? See, when I read the book of Hebrews, the one thought, and you'll hear me repeat this over to you and over to you, is why do we want to settle for less than the best? Why would we want to settle for the religious part of this when we could have Jesus himself? That his spirit can live inside of us. And sometimes we become content, do we not? Just down here. School starting, how many of you young people are going to be content just to get a C in class? Or do you want to have an A? Well, Kate needs straight A's anyway, right? Just, yeah. Yeah. After the first 9 weeks, you can bring your report card and show this out. Right? Why settle for less than the best? You know, one of the things that concerns me, I think about, is to stand before God one day and say, Joe, you could have all of this. All of this. And you settle for this. I told people before that God wants us to give us a steak and we're satisfied with a hamburger. He wants to give us $100 and we're satisfied with a nickel. That we don't know what God has for us because we won't give him the opportunity to do that. He has the ability in all of these things. Now you're sitting there thinking, boy, if you give me a bunch of money, I'd like that. That's not the point. The point is I'm settling for far less than what Jesus has to offer me. Okay? Because we look at I have no idea what's next. Just leave mine. Okay. The superior position that Christ holds. I want you to share with me what is his relationship to the universe. Look in the passage. What is his relationship to the universe? And Danny, you don't need to say any more. And by the way, you're paying for lunch now. I was going to. What is his relationship to the universe? He made it and, you're right.
Completed error.
Pardon me?
He's
an error of all this, but one more deal he says about the universe. He created it and he sustains it. Love makes the world go round, doesn't it? Nope. Money makes the world go round, doesn't it? Nope. What makes the world go round? Jesus. He created it, he sustains it. Our world is still going around today because he has decided it would. That's all that keeps it going. Okay? I see more and more in my attitude to become this too. Whoever is elected president of the United States, Jesus is still king. He's running this. He's running this. And we may have our preferences, and that's okay. That's okay. But he is in control. And I believe with all my heart that the next president of the United States has been ordained by God to be the president. It may not be who we think, but it may be God knows. He sustains it. Every little bit, I mean, I can go through all the scientific facts for you. You know, if this earth traveled a mile an hour faster or slower, life would be impossible. If we were about a half a mile one way or the other from the sun, life would be impossible. I mean, it runs exactly how it has to run in order to be sustained. So who has that power? Jesus does. He is the creator. What about his relationship to God? We've talked some about this. What is his relationship to God? And he's the Son. He is the radiance. He is the glory. I'm sorry?
He's the voice of God.
He's the voice of God. He has expressed the heart of God. All of this, his relationship to his Father is that he is the Son. What is his relationship to us? Savior, because why? What did he do?
Right.
He died for us. He forgave our sins. He has given us the power to live. And after he did all this, what did he do? He sat down at the right hand in majesty. Okay. Remember the old movies, The Right Hand Man? Okay. Bob is George's right hand man, which shows that George is still in control. Right, Bob? Well, he agreed to this. What did it mean, right hand man? If somebody was somebody's right hand man, what did it mean? Okay, you're on the right track. If that was somebody's right hand man, the right hand man had the same authority as the one that was in control. And where is Jesus sitting now? At the right hand of the Father. Okay? He's sitting on the throne with the Father, that he has that kind of power. That kind of power. He is seated in honor. Nobody else sits in that position that Jesus sits in. Nobody. And you'll notice that the rest of chapter 1, he deals with angels, because not so much anymore. I don't hear a lot about angels, but we used to hear a lot about angels. The misrepresentation of angels, all those kinds of things. We've elevated them to be something equal to God, and no, not at all. Not at all. In fact, we as human beings, if we're believers in Jesus, when we leave this world, we're much higher than angels. Not even close. Not even close. Okay? So he is superior in his position. I recall, this happened a couple of years ago, talking to this little boy about Christmas. And he said, well, I don't know if it's going to be Christmas or not, because so far, we bought the doll with a fake bone. We put up a fake wreath. We put up a fake tree. So I guess it'll just be a fake Christmas. When we have so much fake and false, is it just false Christianity then? If we just put up artificial this, artificial that, and we never really got back to the true thing? See, Jesus holds this position. It's not a matter of artificial. It's a matter of that Jesus is in that position. We speak with his power. Okay? We look at the position that he had. He's creator of all things. He's the ruler of the universe. And notice here, though, it says that he created the world, but the word for world there is not the normal one. Okay? The word for the world is cosmos, which means order. But this is the never word. It's talking about history. The ages is actually what it means. He's talking about the dealings of men, not just the physical earth. He's talking about the dealings of men, and that he has the power over all of this. Do we ascribe that kind of power to him? When we look at Jesus, it's past, present, future. In fact, one of the words that we use under the covenant for God is Yahweh. And that word means I was, I am, I will be, that he is eternal. That Jesus has this power for eternity. Does that get our heart beating a little bit more? That he is the sustainer of the universe. That he created this. He maintains it. He sustains it. He does. Not anybody else but him. And then he is the heir of all things. Have we ever considered the fact that the Bible says that Jesus is our older brother? That he is the older brother. That he inherits it all. Not that which he inherits is us. It's us. That he is the heir of all things. That he has all this power. All this power. Okay? And then we finally get to the point where he is the purpose of Christ is superior. He offers himself. He is the redeemer of mankind. He bought me back. What was the price that he had to pay to buy me back? His life, his blood. That must mean, Mary, that we're pretty important. If the Son of God would die just to redeem us, that makes us very important, but also means his purpose is of great importance. That once and for all, he offered this sacrifice for sin. Now, we may get into this later on, but we're not going to try today, but if you were in the Old Testament, you got back into the Old Testament, they had to keep every year offering sacrifice for sin. Okay? But Jesus, once and for all, once and for all, he made that sacrifice. And you know, there are phrases in the Bible that, well, I'll be guilty too. This one, I don't know how many times I've read this passage. And it finally came down to me what the phrase means that it says he sat down. Now, in my reading, I found out that in the Old Testament temple, there were no chairs. Why? Because the priests were never done working. There was never a time that they just sat down because there's always something to do. When we're looking at Jesus, says he sat down, it means his work's done. Everything has been accomplished. That he sat down. Nothing else can be done that Jesus hasn't already done for us. That his work is complete. You know, in John 19, when Jesus dies, what is one of the things that John says he cries out? It is finished. Okay? That is a declaration of success. There's one word. One word that is translated, it is finished, and it means we have reached the goal. We've accomplished the task. We've done the work. So I never have to be concerned about whether Jesus is sufficient for me in my life, because what does it say he did when he did this? He sat down. Everything's complete. Everything is done. There's nothing else to be done that Jesus hasn't already accomplished here. He's offered himself. So why stay faithful? Because the truth of who Jesus is should motivate us to remain faithful. If we would just spend a little time thinking about this, there are every reason to stay faithful. Because he is the person. He is the position to save me. He has the power. He has the purpose to accomplish our salvation. Why would we want to settle for less than the best? It's up to us whether we do that. We can live our lives and just mess with this and play with this, and maybe at moments it might be important. Most times it's not important. And we can do that at the very end. And a great explanation of that is that the tense of those verbs is different. Jesus said, if you continue to deny me in front of men, there will be this one time I'll deny you, period. In John chapter 6, Jesus feeds the 5,000, and that also Matthew 14 is where Peter walks on the water. This is the same event always happening. And Jesus walks on the water, and he's on the other side of the lake, and the people walk all the way around the lake to find him because they want what? Free lunch. He fed us over there, he can feed us over here. But then Jesus goes deeper. He preached three different sermons, all of them the bread of life sermons about spiritual life, because that's far more important. Your spiritual life and spiritual bread is more important than what you have for breakfast.
Amen.
Okay? And he preaches those three, and in the end, what do the people do? One of the saddest things that I've ever seen. He's got 5,000 people there, plus women and children. And when he gets done preaching the sermon, excuse me, it says that many left and walked with him. Folks, that those words mean that they never came back. And it's amazing to me that as Jesus stood there, he left.
I don't think you can play with
You
have to work at it every day.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely.
If you slip, you
got to
repent for that.
Oh, absolutely. I'm talking about you, Bob.
Both.
Both. No, you're right. But the correct thing here, Mary, is that it's not a matter of my effort. It's a matter of my submission to Jesus.
Right.
That it's his power that keeps me faithful.
He gave us the power of reason. He showed them the way. He showed them what they had to do, and they didn't do it. I gave you the choice.
Oh, absolutely. They didn't want the best. They were willing to just settle for what they already had, and look what they missed. Okay? except for one guy. His name was Peter. Because when these people got up and they started walking away, what does Jesus say to Peter and the disciples? You guys want to leave too? Remember what Peter said? Where would we go? You have the words of eternal life. So if you're not going to get serious with Jesus, where are you going to go? Who are you going to go to? Okay. Now, I'm not going to get deeper into this. It's time for us to go. But even Jesus says, then I wonder if you is the God. So, folks, just because we're sitting in church doesn't mean we're saved. Just because we're here doesn't mean we got this together. Mm-hmm. And it was Judas that was there, just like the others. And good point, Bob, because he had a choice. He could. Absolutely. He had the same choice as these other guys. He just did not accept. So this morning, are you just going to settle for less the best? Is what you've got in your little religious world enough? Are you just satisfied with all that? Or are we wanting the best? And the best is Jesus himself. Because there's nothing to compare. Nothing to compare. I should have got third day up here. If they were in town, they would have the same. Have you ever heard that song, Nothing Compares to Knowing You, Lord? Oh, an unbelievable song. Okay? So it's up to you. We see who Jesus is. We see what he possesses. You want the best? Or are you just going to settle for whatever else that you can settle for? But if you don't come to Jesus, who are you going to go? Who are you going to go to? Our hymn of invitation, dedication, is people need the Lord. And that's us too, that we need him. We need him to be our Lord and our Savior. So we're going to stand together and we're going to sing as people need the Lord.